Jadi macam mana kita nak mulakan? Mungkin saya boleh terus tanyalah sebab ini filem Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalang ni tahun 1993, jadi bermakna 31 tahun yang lalu. Tapi saya pernah tengok, ini versi broadcast menurut saudara Ali yang siap, sebab seingat saya macam ada adegan nasi kangkang dalam filem sebenarnya. Jadi yang ni kita tak nampak lah tadi. Tak ada. Jadi kalau siapa yang first time tengok, dia ada satu adegan tu bila suami dia makan dan dia jemput sekali isteri dia. Kenapa tak makan sekali? Tapi Sofia tak makan sebab sebelum tu ada scene dia nasi kangkang. So dia macam itulah.
Oh, tadi tunjuk?
Tadi tak ada. Okay. Tadi versi TV. Yeah. Okay. Jadi just untuk pengatuan audience yang first time, kalau first time tengok filem ni. Jadi mungkin kita nak ke mana? Okay, saya boleh bermula dengan soalan personal saya. Jadi mungkin kalau biasanya dalam bentuk teater dan setahu saya juga macam saudara U-Wei juga pernah mengarah Wangi Jadi Saksi, pernah menulis play, Sofia juga pernah berlakon Laut Lebih Indah Dari Bulan, 6 Round. Jadi kalau dalam teater biasanya proses karakter itu kita berjalan selari sebab kita di depan hadapan audiens sebenar. So the character punya journey tu kronologi. Tapi filem dia berbeza sebab dia filem mechanical sikit. Bila kita shoot kadang-kadang editing tu dia boleh di mana-mana. Jadi soalan saya kepada dua-dualah, sebab menariknya hari ini kita ada U-Wei, seorang pengarah yang kita akan dapat jawapan yang saya harap, ataupun bagi saya bila pengarah dia dapat memberi jawapan yang berbentuk overview, manakala kita ada leading actress Sofia, mungkin jawapannya lebih dari position watak. Jadi menarik, mungkin soalan kita ada satu soalan tapi kita boleh dapat dua perspektif berbeza. Jadi soalan saya tadi, saya nak, kalau ingatlah scene mana yang first di shooting dan terakhir di shooting dari perspektif pengarah dan juga pelakon, ya. Kalau ingat, ya. Saya dulu.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Filem ini saya shoot 100 tahun dulu. Lamanya dan kali ini saya dapat peluang tengok yang ujungnya, sebab saya sangat jarang melihat karya saya. Tapi hanya ini saya dah lama tak tengok, jadi ujung tadi saya tengoklah. Nak ingat balik agak sukar kan, yang shoot yang scene mana yang awal, mungkin Sofia boleh tolong. Lupa
I believe,
kan, lupa tu martabat yang paling tinggi.
Hello everybody, assalamualaikum. Perhaps I will just speak in English and bahasa Malaysia as well. So mungkin saya rasa untuk filem Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalang, can we even say the word? We can, right? Yeah. So Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalang, I believe babak yang pertama adalah babak perkahwinan, persediaan perkahwinan Amir dan Zaliha.
Benar.
Di Kampung Temai Ulu di Pekan Pahang. So that was dan saya mengingati bahawa itu adalah opening scene babak yang pertama yang memulakan the journey of Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalang, kerana saya tidak ada di situ. Saya sepatutnya tidak ada di situ sebab tidak ada Zaliha di dalam babak-babak yang permulaan Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalang. Tetapi UA insisted that I be there, even though I'm not supposed to be working, to be there untuk mendapat rasa, untuk mendapat, to gauge apa yang kita baca, the process of script to screen. So he wanted, and that process untuk menggambar, untuk penggambaran babak-babak yang pertama itu pun melalui beberapa hari. I think about 3 to 4 days of that. 3 to 4 days, I'm sure, because it was a huge scene yang membabitkan ramai extras, orang-orang kampung dan persediaan ala kampung, orang yang bakal berkahwin. So I remember that was the first scene that you shot for Perempuan Isteri dan Jalang. Dan yang terakhir, I also believe was the death scene. Adalah babak akhir itu, iaitu where Amir membunuh Zaliha dalam keadaan amuknya itu.
Jadi lebih kurang, betul dia macam menurut kronologi sebab
Tapi in between bukan kronologi, tetapi the opening and the closing of the film was, yes.
Ini yang pertama kan, pasal dialog yang pertama tu kan, Assalamualaikum, memberi salam pada sinema Malaysia. Saya film saya pertama kan. Ya, benar.
Jadi mungkin selain kita berbual kan, saya juga just tertanya je nak tahu kalau sesiapa ada berniat nak bertanya, mungkin boleh angkat tangan. Ini berniat je, belum tanya. Sebab kalau ramai saya buka awal sikit lah untuk slowly. Tapi kalau tak berniat saya boleh simpan lambat sikit. Ada yang lepas menonton filem yang intense tadi, ada ke sesiapa rasa nak bertanya sesuatu? Tak ada pandangan lagi. Okey, tak apa-apa. Saya just nak check je. Okey. Jadi kita boleh ke seterusnya. Jadi tentang judul tu sendiri macam yalah censorship lah selalunya. Jalang tu disensor, macam boleh kita saya kongsikan sikit bagaimana. Yeah.
Filem ni dia melalui penapis filem, dan filem ni mungkin bukan saja image dia di sensor hingga kan tajuk dia kan. Jadi bila dia sensor, saya semasa tu umur saya mungkin berapa tahun, 30 tahun. Jadi saya sangat agak marah lah. Jadi saya pergi berjumpa LPF. Saya cakap anda harus mensensor gambar, tapi anda mensensor tajuk dia. Jadi banyak saya tak setuju. Jadi yang ini salah satu sebab saya jarang atau tidak avoid menonton filem ni, sebab dia sangat disensor. Dia sangat banyak disensor kan, jadi banyak hilang. Jadi saya agak tak senang tengok. Jadi I'm not sure whether you have seen the uncensored one or not. Tapi saya rasa kalau dia Ali ambil the Sia the Astro, itu the censored tu. Yeah, itu sebab. Yeah. Itu jawapan.
Boleh just nak saja. Sebab dia censorship tu ada berlayer-layer juga, yang theatrical release dengan LPF satu, lepas tu dengan TV.
Itu saya tak setuju tu kan. Jadi dia censor. Jadi siapa yang komplain pasal censorship, saya lalui teruk lah. Awal.
Just out of curiosity, I see apa ni, kamar ni penuh. So I'm just wondering whether most of the people here are actually from film, studying film. I know Hanzalini is here, he's an actor. Tetapi mungkin yang lain artists or just people who love films. I'm not sure. Ataupun kombinasi semua. Or just people who are curious to see how old we are.
Boleh silakan.
Prior to this film, making this movie, you ada experience maknanya industry itself, maknanya how the level of censorship, maknanya from maknanya the height of censorship kat Malaysia ni is during 90s. At the same time, the height of Malay filmmaking masa 90s juga kan.
Ada
target.
Saya tidak ada pengalaman dengan censorship board. Saya tahu saya harus berkarya, saya juga rasa hati tu kan. Ini kan filem ni kan tentang marah dan juga tak puas hati kan. Macam bila Amir tanya, Abang Amir macam tu aja, dia nak lebih kan. Jadi saya ada sikap nak lebih tu dalam filem ni. Jadi dan tanpa marah tadi kan. Jadi jawapan anda, saya tidak tahu. Saya tak ada pengalaman dengan censorship board. Kerana saya
meaning baptism by fire lah. Baptism, to use the term, baptism by fire lah. You were the first time you were in film, and then just terus.
Sebab saya tidak, saya by prinsip saya tidak percaya dengan censorship. Tapi saya dengan censorship, kita ada censorship. Tapi saya tidak percaya tentang censorship sebuah karya tu. Tapi saya percaya tentang censorship audience. Macam saya tidak setuju je kalau di tepi rumah saya ada orang menjual pornografi kan. Dan itu saya tak percaya. Jadi saya mesti audience mesti disensor, bukan karya pada saya. Sebab saya itu kan. Ya. Marah kan.
Jadi mungkin saya boleh kongsi juga sebab saya dah lama tak tengok yang pertama saya tengok VCD VCD yang lain sikit. Satu lagi
tak tengok di panggung.
Saya tak sempat. Saya dah 93 tu saya dah jadi. So jadi satu yang saya ingat first viewing saya dalam bentuk VCD bila watak Zaliha nak pergi mandi sungai, tiba-tiba ada Sofia filter. Dia macam bagi saya dia mengejutkan. Tapi saya faham kenapa, lepas tu saya baru fikir balik kenapa dia mandi sungai dia ada, saya tahu betul ke tak ada Sofia filter. Oh tak ada ya?
Dia banyak censorship sebenarnya dalam banyak censorship. Endak pula Sofia kan sebab dia bermain, dia betul-betul push the vocabulary lakonan dalam sexuality kan. Di mana masa mengintai contoh saya ingat nasi kangkang tu mesti tak ada, tak ada. Dia tentang mengintai. Jadi at one point dia masa tapa mengintai kan, tengok dia sebenarnya dia, ada tak dia kipasnya, dia panas ke dapur tu, dia ambil tu dikipas dia. Jadi ada shot dia yang dia pandang ke audience. Macam pandang kat korang pun mengintai lah. Dia banyak momen-momen tu. Dan ujungnya akhirnya bila dia mati sebenarnya bukan dia dibunuh, iaitu Amir anggap dia sebagai satu penyakit kan. Jadi bila dia dibawa keluar, dia kamera saya pan kepada orang kampung di situ, sign relief ya. Jadi shot sebenarnya yang saya tak include, dia akhirnya dia pergi kat muka saya. Jadi lepas tu saya dalam series ni saya senyum. Message saya is just a movie. Yeah. Sebenarnya tapi kerana ikut kenapa kan saya khawatir tak dia tak come across kan.
And the producer would not allow it.
Yeah. Dia kira break apa the fourth wall yang layer lain lah, level lain lah, betul lah.
Dia yang ujung tu kan last shot tu, itu semua sexual tentang tidak ada orang dewasa kan. Last shot tu polis bawa dia, itu budak kecil. Dia kan tengok ada simbol UMNO, simbol rocket, socialis, kambing, kepala lembu. Ya, itu pelik. Dan these guys yang kecil ni akan go through political kan, ada macam ketubah ni, ada macam potential leader ni itu. Kemudian ada budak baru khatam bersunat kan, itu tentangnya you gonna grow up, sexuality dah timbul dah, itu future tu. Bagi the last shot tu, there's a future of budak-budak tu yang akan jadi apa yang jadi pada bila dewasa, kejadian yang mereka kita telah lalui. Does it make sense?
Jadi macam filem ni itulah sebab kita bagi saya ialah it's just a movie tadi mengingatkan saya balik pada ialah filem ni memang menggambarkan orang panggil relationship yang tak tahu nak kata toxic ke apa, memang sangat berbahaya. Tapi mungkin bukan berguna, tapi dalam kehidupan seharian sebenar kita memang tak patutlah, tapi dalam filem lah ruang untuk kita dapat melihat. Dan macam mana saya rasa menariknya filem ni, kamera tu dia stay dekat siapa, sebab dia boleh, kalau bagi saya lah, kalau kadang-kadang violence yang dipaparkan dalam sinema, kalau dia terlebih berat sebelah, nanti dia dia terlebih macam mana kata, bagi saya dia boleh tersight dengan satu keganasan tu. Tapi dalam filem ni dia bagi saya dia balance, sebab dia kadang-kadang dia ada momen yang, terutama lah bagi saya bila dia stay dengan Zaliha, kita dapat ada satu tadi yang saya baru perasan detail, dia senyum bila kena tangkap kawat orang tu. Orang-orang apa yang tangkap kawat tu, yeah, kahwin, lepas tu tiba-tiba stay dengan Zaliha, Zaliha macam, yeah, smile. Maksudnya, yeah, dia macam ada satu revenge yang terpendam yang, yeah, macam,
yeah, yeah. Benar.
Saya macam nak tanya sesuatu kepada Sofia, tapi apa soalan? Kalau ada sesiapa boleh bantu, kalau, ya. Yeah. Tak ada.
Biar.
Hi, assalamualaikum, I'm Syami. So anyway, this is my first time watching this film. And like watching Sofia Jane for Haji Wei punya first feature, so I think like amazing lah how you wrote the story and even Sofia perform as Zaliha. So my question macam, I can't really like how the character grow, especially for Zaliha, from how dia from dekat Siam and then balik ke rumah apa ni, Amir, and sampailah how dia how say like blossom dekat kampung tu in a way, like how she took over the village lah in a way. So in term of preparation as a actor with Haji Wei sendiri as a director, how you guys collaborate to developing such amazing characters as Zaliha, and how like in term of layering and type of character secara halus, you know, like in term of even like I think there's like a great process there. About I think I saw like such a great performance in like because it's not easy, like you want to show satu perempuan jalang, but in a way the how Sofia plays like really subtle lah in a way, like that's why I think like it doesn't force me to see dia sebagai seorang perempuan jalang. It's like macam a lot of dynamics and color in there. So yeah, perspective as an actor and as a director.
Thank you for that question. So I think I was short of 2 months sebelum I turned 21 on set. Yeah, we started in January. Wow, I remember all these things. Dan kalau mungkin pada mereka yang mungkin tidak mengenali saya, those who may not have, who know me, I started with no experience. I never went to acting school. I never went to university. I never went to, I never had any formal training in acting. And I started very early after my O-levels, selepas SPM. I dived in straight into, it was just a stroke of luck. I just got into acting by accident. Started as an extra, then I got a couple of words and lines, and then lepas tu, we went on to supporting, and then finally I did dramas, TV dramas, at that time, which was a very booming industry. Late 80s, 90s, until Perempuan, Isteri, dan Jalang is not my first film. I actually did another film before that, a couple of films before that, but in very small doses. So when I realized that I needed to reflect on why am I being an actor, I love it, but I didn't know how to pursue it. And I did not know how to find that formal education because I thought it was too late. Dan even though I was still very early in life, tetapi I had a lot of obligations financially, family, so I had to work. So I did not have that time to pursue it. And I knew that walaupun saya bekerja non-stop dalam industri drama dan sedikit di dalam filem, bila U-Wei balik ke Malaysia dari America, was it New York? Yeah, he came back from New York. Before he started on Perempuan, Isteri, dan Jalang, he had already done a few series of TV dramas. And when I saw his work, I said, this is what I want to do. This is the kind of work that I want to do. where I can sort of like have an analytical reading, critical thinking, but I didn't think I was good enough. That's why I never did that kind of work. Faham tak? So, and then we had Shuhaimi Baba, Adman Saleh. So this was a modern era of drama and film, modern stories, maybe the same stories from back from the 70s and 80s, but then now it was a different take because it was a different form of art, content, form, and social significance in the stories that they were portraying. So, apabila Berjaya Film membuat satu pengumuman, they made an announcement that U-Wei Haji Saari was going to do his first film, then there was going to be an open audition for the main roles. I went, but you rejected me. And you rejected me, along with everybody else in the room. And I was very upset because I thought, even though I knew why, I knew the reason why I was rejected, because I wasn't good enough. I did not have enough experience, life experience especially, I think. And somehow, macam mana, I persuaded the producer, I didn't know him, but I mean like production, can I please have a second chance? And then we met again, kan? We met again, and this time I think you asked me to do a reading. And I always believe that you took me because you were so fed up with me. Fed up with me coming back and back, pursuing this role, which I know in my heart I needed so badly. I needed this break. And it wasn't a break untuk saya menjadi satu superstar. I needed this platform to learn. And I thought, who better to learn than with U-Wei Haji Saari? So that itu adalah permulaan sejarah saya dengan Cik U-Wei Haji Saari. So, and of course, saya pada waktu ini sudah berdepan dengan Nasir Bilal Han dan Kak Numa Damanghuri, pelbagai aktor, female actors, male actors who were so experienced dari segi theater and film and drama, countless films and dramas. Now, not only do I have to handle him, I have to handle the other actors as well. And I was so young, saya hanya 20 tahun pada waktu itu. And you know, and this story, when I read it, you know, it was about a forbidden woman, basically. That's what I thought. And I thought, wow, okay. And so we had the reading, and then we had script reading. And I think we had rehearsals, intensive rehearsals like you always do, selama sebulan. At least sebulan lebih. So, and I think with U-Wei, I think everybody knows that you never change his words. Even though you may not like them, you don't change them because he will always counter argue and ask me why you want to change the words. And so that was my process pembelajaran saya dalam dunia lakonan. So thank you. And
I thank her.
so when I watch, when people say, oh, and I never knew who knew this was going to be such an iconic film. I mean, the rebellion. The voice of rebellion and liberation of women in this film became the inspiration for generations after that. You know what I mean? Satu generasi lepas tu were inspired by this film. Then, no lah. So, you know, and I was so green, saya sangat hijau when I first started. I didn't even know what I was doing, you know? I didn't even know what I was doing. I just followed instructions. That's what I did. I had to listen, I had to learn, and I think my biggest form of learning at this point was observation. Observing other actors, seasoned actors, Nasir with his big, huge theatrical acting in film, which was, you know what I mean? Which people would go, oh my God, people today would say overacting. But at that point, it was something so modern, so new, that we have actually seen in other films from all over the world. But I don't think we have actually seen it in Malaysia, besides Bangsawan. In film, you know, so it was a new era for filmmakers, for actors as well, because now the finally we get to experiment. But I didn't know any of that, of course, because I didn't even know what acting was. You know what I mean? So I had to do a lot of observation, observing all these great actors on set, cara mereka bekerja, and I sort of like became a copycat. I just copied what everybody was doing, yeah, and sort of imitating in a way, and thought, okay, I'll write this out. I think I can do it. And And it was very nerve-wracking for a 20-year-old, but I when I watch it sometimes, I think, oh, I remember the moments of what I was going through, because I knew there were times where he was not happy with me at all. You cannot hide your your disgrace for me sometimes. But so that was my process as an actor. Of course, it will be different daripada pelakon-pelakon yang lain kerana mereka dah mengenali UA lebih lama dan mereka pun dah bekerja dengan lebih lama. So that was my first footing into learning. This was my learning acting school. This was my learning university experience, which was with U-Wei Haji Saari.
Yeah. Okay, terima kasih untuk ada. Okay. Boleh silakan.
Okay, I think you have to talk some more because I want to ask the question to you.
Oh dear. Okay.
What was the process of acting like? You know, nowadays we have intimacy director, and you know, at that time it's like you were young. Mm. How was the experience like in those kind of that you had to do those kind of scenes? Mm. And as well as I want to know, like, because you didn't have much life experience, so what or who did you draw all these experiences from to portray her? Because she looks like a woman who has seen the world. Like, I'm done, you know. She had that confidence.
Yeah. Okay, this is great because this whole exhibition is about the 90s. Then, when I was 17, 16, when we would go clubbing in KL in the 90s, after you finish clubbing, what we would do, we would actually go to dark areas of Bukit Bintang, Jalan Pudu, and we would actually go look at prostitutes' work. That was the highlight of my teenage years. When we after clubbing, that's what we would do. After clubbing, minum teh tarik, and then after that, let's go and see what are the women doing, and what are the the drags doing, you know, that, because that was what added color to Kuala Lumpur at 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning before going back home, and also, at that point when I first started out, I had a wonderful, on set, I had a wonderful team, Sutek, who did the costume, and Nan, who was my makeup artist. And, and we would just walk the city and experience, you know, just watching and observing people, you know, at 2 o'clock in the morning, at 3 o'clock in the morning. This was prior to starting this shoot. And I thought, oh, not no difference than what I did when I was 17, 18. And I think it was just picking up the energy, a bit of body language, and trying to create somebody that I don't even know. I mean, that's what actors do, right? You try to create or try to embody somebody that you don't really know, but you see every day on the streets, you know? So so that was, and because I didn't have that life experience, bila kita masuk ke set, we went into set, and I had to do, hugging and sexual body gestures and stuff like that. I feel there's a bit of awkwardness there because I'm not really. I do feel it. I go like, like when she's rubbing herself against the beam of the door, and she's going I'm going like, oh, like I was, and obviously I was not to say uncomfortable. I just didn't know how to do it, you know. But I think what kept me alive while going through all those sequences was I felt very safe. It was a set that was pretty much dominated by men, you know, more male actors than there were female actors. And all your workers, the crew, the production crew was predominantly men, you know. So, but I was in a very safe environment where semua pelakon-pelakon lelaki really looked after me. There was never any hanky-panky. They were very respectful, and they were also aware that I also didn't know what I was doing. So they were very, very helpful with that, and I always appreciate that. So So that's how I arrived to what you see on screen. Yes.
Jadi mungkin bersambung dari itu, saya just terfikir macam mana. Tadi ada satu scene yang sewaktu di Siam. Bila Amir bawa Zaliha Dajjal ke tu, kemudian ada intercut apa 6 bulan kemudian. Tapi bila selepas 6 bulan kemudian, yang kita tengok Zaliha tu betul-betul transform. Bagi saya lah, saya tengok betul-betul berubah. Jadi saya just nak tahu proses untuk betul-betul dapatkan dengan sesimpel itu perubahan tu. Yeah.
Yeah. Saya kalau anda tengok skrip originalnya dia tebal tu. Ya, dia banyak scene hilang. Hendak pula scene di Siam. Just to a phrase you said that when you put when he back kampung dia macam very well informed woman as a woman towards men, because there's a scene setelah dibeli balik oleh Amir dengan harga RM6, the reason is RM6 is if you melt our body from our body is made of iron, calcium, yeah, and proteins, yeah? If you melt that, nilai ya only RM3 saja. That's when I learn about that information. It's all our calcium, our teeth is melted, you know? So I double it, make it six ringgit. Yeah. Because Amir is making a point to disgrace her, because you know he gives a time limit. But when there's a scene after that, before that, you know, at a restaurant where she was after she been bought, she have that, she learned a lot, you know, she have the power of attracting men. And there's a scene that, watch it, I'm sure that man will look at me, you know, there's a scene in that, you know, tapi dia buang, because she attracts men, you know, she, because of the time she was in Siam, you know, there was a scene there, you know. So you know, that's why she comes very confident after that, because she knows about the weaknesses of men, you know. That's why she's very confident setelah balik tu. So the thing is being cut short sebab about time.
Maksudnya dilakukan penggambaran lah.
Tapi tidak tak jadi di.
But the script, because there's a lot of thing yang hilang, because I didn't shoot it because it's getting too long.
Okay, yeah, good. Jadi tadi.
But it's very interesting bila Ridhwan bercakap mengenai proses 6 bulan and how somebody a girl from a kampung boleh pergi ke Siam. Dalam keadaannya sebegitu, dipaksa, dirogol dan dijual, and how she can change so drastically. Because, and it's interesting because in the 90s it was the migration of women or young girls from all over kampungs in all over the states of Malaysia, where a lot of them would come to so the liberation of women had already started in the 90s and 80s. Women who go and work in factories would come from all over. You know, in the 90s, women who came and, you know, with friends and with no parents, no men, no nothing. So it was interesting because in the 90s, you see that, you know, macam Minakilang, kan? You know, and all these women were not from KL. They all came from all over the states, right, to look for this liberation, to be an independent woman, you know? But of course, the difference between them and Zaliha was obviously her migration was to the border of Thailand to become a prostitute, which I don't think was an unusual thing either, for young girls to also migrate to certain states or to cross over to by force or, you know, or by accident or whatever. So it was a very interesting times and stories as well that happened in those early 90s. Yang saya rasa tak begitu. We don't talk about it as often as we should, or tak dibincangkan. So so this, when you say the drastic change, you should have seen the drastic change of girls who kerja kat kilang, and how on weekends they will be out in KL at night, and they were totally different person than daripada apa yang mak bapak dia ingat di kampung. And it's true. So the evolution of women and young women in the 90s in Kuala Lumpur was mind blowing. You see it, you just don't acknowledge it until we talk about it, you know?
Yeah, I think girls, they are survivors, you know? They survive, they adapt, you know? And that's what Zaliha was forced into a situation, but she will survive. That's why she basically this film is about alienation, you know? Yeah, it's putting somebody not in your habitat. basically the story is about that. Yeah? So she's been twice been put, one in the Siam, where it's not her habitat at all, where she had to learn to deal with men. Yeah? And then she's been forcibly again dibawa balik kepada kampung dia di mana dia tak kenal satu orang pun. Jadi dia survive. You know? So it's about woman that survive. You know? That's why if you put anything and situation on woman, they will survive. They will adapt and survive. That's our fitrah kita, nature kita. You know? That's what. Yeah. And then, yeah. Yeah, they survive. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Amir gave her $3, again. She survived. She can convince the tukang jahit dan penjaga kain tu. Dia pandai dia hutangnya dia. Yeah. Dia ada limited. Yeah. That limitation. Yeah. She can survive. Conquer the world macam tu kan, yeah. Satu kampung. That's why I said just now, bila dia mati, pada orang ramai a relief, you know, macam relief, ah. Macam penyakit, you know? Because she influence a lot. Even laki dia pun dia tunduk kan, you know? Dia nasi kangkang dia tak? Itu you understand, eh? The Malay woman in kampung, the last thing they resort is bomo. That's the last resort. So, and as a Malay kampung boy, the first knowledge a kampung boy will learn is about herbs, daun. You go walk into outside your house, you know which tahu pokok-pokok apa tu, apa yang tak boleh makan, apa racun. So there is a shot of her. I don't know whether it's. Then I remember shooting Sofia walking near the going to take a bath, and then she come across a little boy, oh, yeah. And then she said that is poisonous, because she's aware, she's that's what she learned as a kampung girl, and just to sidetrack, one of the reason that Sofia said I rejected her first time. Because she's too white, you know. Remember, eh? Because she's Caucasian, and then that's why you see notice, we have to make her up, makeup, kan? Kita make up the whole body sebenarnya tau. But you know, but then I changed my mind because there's one word she said, you know, after the second meeting. The reason for the second meeting, you all know that I'm attracted to that feature, you know, that's why there's a second chance, kan? And she said, if you want to something, I just paraphrase. Kalau kena nak salahkan aku, if you blame me for what I am, this is what I am, you know. But if you doubt my jiwa as a Malay, you're wrong. That. Confirm me. You got it. I said, that year you got it. I cannot help myself being white. Yeah. That I remember. Yeah. Because I want to get. Because remember, I want to make a change from film. Sebelum itu kan? Sebab sebelum itu semua Pan Asian. Susan Lancaster, Ramona Raman. Siapa tu yang Julia Raiz, all of them. So I said, I'm not gonna follow it. Yeah. So when she comes across, sayang. Yeah. But when she reads and she said that word, you know, and I know I can coach a lot of people that to act, you know, I know that because that's what I learned, you know. I went to school for that, but the important thing when she said, if you doubt my jiwa Melayu, you are wrong. Itu yang seal the deal tu. Okay. That's it. Okay. You got it. Yeah.
Jadi, bila bersambung dari itu juga macam bercakap tentang kalau sinema Melayu dari era studio tadi.
I'm not anti-Pan Asian.
Okay.
Don't get me wrong.
Ah, yeah, yeah.
I'm not anti-Pan Asian. No. Yeah. My children are Pan Asian. Yeah. Okay.
Tadi bila saya tonton tu lah, macam saya mengingatkan bila scene terakhir, adegan terakhir tu intensity dia macam dalam filem Hang Jebat. Dan yang awal tu pula dia ada macam rasa teringat Sri Mersing sikit. So dia macam ada underlying, dia macam ada dialog tersembunyi di antara sinema punya culture lah. Maksudnya bagi saya benda tu penting sebab dia ada petautan dan dia makin bertambah-bertambah. Walaupun macam tadi scene di adegan akhir tu betul-betul feeling dia intensity Hang Jebat, Hang Tua semua tu, tapi karakter dia lain dah. Karakter dah fully fledged dekat dalam filem ni. Kita dah kenal Zaliha siapa, kita dah kenal Tapa, kita dah kenal Amir. Dan Amir tu macam betul-betul, tadi bila saya tengok rasa memang dia macam monster betul. Dia macam, dia ada satu scene tu dia pegang lampu suluh baru lepas dapat garam tu, macam something yang horrifying bergerak. So macam maksudnya kita dah kenal. Dan scene akhir tu Tapa dengan parang, dengan senjata, Amir masuk gitu je. Maksudnya dia memang tak takut mati. Dia dah memang transcend lain dah. Dia dah.
Yeah, it's wise.
Yeah.
Dia, kita buat. I just want to add. I believe in tradition. I have strong belief because if you do not get your work from traditional, then you are plagiarize. So dalam filem ni ada tiga filem sangat penting bagi saya. It derive. Iaitu Sri Mersing. The synopsis of premise of Sri Mersing setabalik kan. I ask, what if Rosnani Jamil follow the man? Yeah, Nordi Ahmad. The other man that went back there. So the other one is Hang Jebat. It's very important. But then I make a twist because she ran away through window kan, dari tingkap dia lagi kan, tangga. So I said she must end her life at the window also. That's why you see the symmetrical kan, dekat tingkap. And then I remember, maybe you forget Sofia, I remember when you die, when you be slashed, you know, I said crawl, I said crawl. To point out that then you're pure like embryo. Then I can make my point that some of the people in the village see as a disease. You know? So it becomes a macam janin balik. You know? So she crawl like that. Yeah? Kan? Yeah. It's unnatural, but just give this for me lah.
Saudara, you sebut tiga film, lagi satu.
Semerah Padi, not Semerah Padi. Sri Mersing, Hang Jebat, dengan Hussein Anim, satu lagi tu. Danom, yeah. Although my favorite is Cucu the Merah, but you know, yeah, because Danom, because perempuan. Apocalypse now. Itu pun sebab you see that the innuendo, the pun, you know, her and Sofia and Zaliha and Tapa, and then the husband is screwing things. My wife been screwed by something. I use that visual. Tapi you are right, I do remember that, you know, yang slaughter tu. Yes, I do, but I couldn't do because of the gushing of the blood. Tak kuat. Tak pula bila dia censor kan. So that's korban saya, gadis. Itu, that's why there's a lot of parallel puns and visual. Yeah.
Kalau kita tengok dalam filem ni, dia banyak maksudnya kamera tu mencari dia bergerak, dia bagi contohnya bila lepas berguling-guling, dia ada gabungan montage berlompat-lompat antara scene, dan juga kamera tu kadang mencari sampai, contohnya bila lepas berguling-guling ada getah, so dia memberi lapisan melalui bahasa filem, ya, ya, tanpa perlu menyatakan. Jadi mungkin kita boleh buka, kita berapa lama kita boleh sambung. Boleh, ada sesiapa ada pertanyaan atau
spawn? Semua baru tengok sekali, first time. Yeah.
Oh. Wow. Ayah, ada. Oh. Ah, ya, yeah, ada.
Thanks.
Okay, so
boleh diri, ayah.
Yeah, awkwardness again. So yeah, my name is Naufal. I wanted to ask this movie. Okay, masa I think it was released 93 kan. So umur I negative 2. Tapi I know like later like macam when it was released it was like quite controversial and so on lah. If you release this movie today with like the society today 2024 Malaysia, do you think it will be as controversial and people will like, you know, watak contohnya watak leha, would people react differently or would it be, you think masyarakat Malaysia sebenarnya sama je 30 tahun lepas sama sekarang?
I think, you know, of course, all this I reflect as I'm older. Of course, I didn't know any of this, and I didn't have any of these thoughts when I was younger. Tetapi, I mean, the story when it first came out, it was a huge, there were huge debates, there were huge critically moral attacks by feminist NGOs, you know, and you're talking about people who are, you know, from women of higher learning, yeah, of from universities, and at that point I was thinking, but it's just a story, you know. I was, you know, and basically about how, why, and how this film degraded, you know, Malay women. But only today do I realize that the story of forbidden zones or forbidden women have been told for many, 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 many years dalam cerita filem Melayu atau drama. It's just that these characters were always relegated to the sidelines because they were just like a sort of like a tool that was needed to push a narrative or push a story. So they were like side stories that were not important. But when Perempuan, Isteri dan Jalan keluar in 1993, the whole story was about this forbidden woman. You know what I mean? And so, and this story basically gave voice to, you know, rebellion and liberation of women that women of the 90s and 80s were actually waiting for. So that's why we actually had half and half of seeing how this film was accepted and rejected. You know, and the perception that people had, this, and don't forget, in the 1990s was also the emergence of this new middle class, Melayu middle class baru. And so when they watched this film, the women of this new middle class was like, that's me, not in that form perhaps as a prostitute or you know, but that's me. That's the liberation that I'm looking for, and that's the rebellion that I'm feeling. That is suddenly I get to see it visually in this film. Whether they liked it or not, it's a different story, but they saw it. So after that, very interestingly, after that, you saw a series of so many filmmakers who wanted to do the same story, but somehow did not achieve what U-Wei Haji Saari did. They never did. Then they never could, because he started this visual of this woman that somehow could not be replicated, because the storyline obviously couldn't be like that. It was different stories, but the story somehow did not achieve what it wanted to say about that woman. So that woman in the other stories were now just like, oh, let's bank in. So because there was kind of like a fad where, oh, I do this story, it's a box office or it's different, therefore everybody else starts doing it. But then they don't achieve the objective because it's not something that was original. That was something that was so, you saw it and thinking, okay, I'll just do this but in a different storyline or a different plot or a love story instead, you know, that kind of thing. So if you ask me today whether it would achieve that, I think yes, because when you have the new generation who watch this film for the first time, they go, oh my God, you actually did films like that in the 90s? Faham tak? like, huh, beraninya buat filem macam tu? Because now you have so much so many platforms where they're so exposed to macam-macam filem mengenai wanita-wanita, many stories, many narratives. They are so used to it. They're so used to this the honesty of storytelling about women that when they watch Perempuan Isteri Jalang, they're like, ah, but I can't believe you did it. So it's very interesting to see generasi baru bila mereka menonton for the first time, and the reaction that they have is basically, well, not as critically moral attack like the last time, but what I'm saying is that they just go, oh my god, I never realized that you could do a film like that. But in actual fact, we've been doing films like that even before in the 60s and 70s.
More risque
too. But it wasn't. But it wasn't a whole story about.
I just nak kongsi satu. Saya setelah membuat filem ni, saya jadi ramai ada macam tayangan. So sekali tu saya dijemput oleh kaum wanita. saya tak nak. Ada orang tak attend. Saya tak nak hadir sebenarnya. Tapi dia macam because I can't stand the attack, you know. And then cakap, no, it's okay, we. You go there, you we will talk. Yeah. I still remember the professor and member. And then, so I watch, and after the screening, she went up and she said, setelah tengok filem ni, hati saya diiris. And I go, hey, I thought you is going to be peaceful here, man. I said, oh. Kemudian dia kata, Wei, why, kenapa buat filem ni? Why do this film? So I'm trying to answer honestly. I said, because I don't know about women. I don't know about women. And then he said, kalau anda tidak tahu, kenapa tulis? Then I realized she's below me lah. Because she doesn't understand the implication of what I'm saying. I don't know women, that's why I write. Because there are three factors of women that interest me. One is their mystery. If I look at a woman, I'm attracted to her because of her mystery. And then of her sexuality. And then how her relationship with the society. So this film encompasses semua tiga-tiga tu kan. That's why I'm attracted to Zaliha, because I want to know the mystery dia. Dia dulu dia mana? You dulu sebelum I boyfriend berapa orang? A man usually as woman. If I know her, I don't need to ask. That's why I told her, because I don't know about woman. And then also, woman, perempuan lah yang menyimpan rahsia saya. That's why I write about woman. That's why I want to keep on writing to understand that. That's why it's no point to understand woman. Rugi lah kan? Yeah, because bila dah faham, buat apa nak tahu kan? You get bored with them at that time, So I knew that my answer doesn't satisfy her. I knew that she's. I said, you should revoke your professorship. You cannot understand the implication of what I'm saying. I write because I don't know. Why should I write things that I know? I said,
as a writer.
Yeah.
As a film writer.
Yeah.
Soalannya.
Saya suka cerita tentang human behavior dan perbuatan. So sebenarnya saya datang sebab saya nak menonton cerita like it's a story, but it's a story about human. Jadi apa yang menarik, saya rasa macam watak Zaliha tu, she has a power, like you said, she has this ability to attract men, and she's really good at it. So I nampak macam interaksi dia kebolehan dia untuk merangsang keberahian, the passion in the other man, right? Tapi yang interesting tu watak Amir, sebab dia macam toxic seperti you kata, tapi dia macam tak boleh let go, dia macam marah, so that is another form of passion, kan? Tapi boleh tak elaborate tentang kenapa Amir tu dia macam tak boleh let go, but he is so marah, he's not let's say not turned on by her, even though she's trying her best to use her power, but the dynamic between them, dia macam marah tau. Boleh tak you elaborate sikit tentang tu, both of you? Yes,
you go. Okay.
he is very attracted to her, very attracted to her. That's why he is a successful business person. He got a truck, ada business, yeah, duit, cash sentiasa ada. So dari kacamata orang kampung dia sukses. Dia travel banyak, okay. Jadi dia ditinggalkan di hari perkahwinan. Sebab apa? Saya masa saya menulis, saya ingat lagi, apa jadi saya kalau saya nak kahwin, bila berhenti perempuan lari. I'm trying to discover that, I'm trying to write the narrative around that incident. Yeah. Jadi dia very attracted to her. That's why to punish her, vengeance, ego dia, that's why she's very loud. You know. Dia jual naingit dia. Yeah. It's poker dia tu. Itu, kalau free tak ada, saya. Kalau naingit tu, kita jauh jatuh mertabak dia. You go down, you know. Lepas tu, dia balik, yeah. Dia as a punishment to her, to Zaliha, dia tak tidur dengan bini dia. To punish her.
Also he thought that he was punishing
her. Yeah, also he thought. Ini when you don't touch your wife, that means you are sort of punishing in a way. You belittle her. Dia tak nak sih. Tetapi setelah dia di ada putih muka, she's very attracted, so she's like, come here, you know. But now she, the bertukar dah. Dia nak nak. Datang bulan lah. So dia diperbaikan. So I bring that, again, the power out into open. Di masa mesyuarat kan balai raya tu, dia bercakap, oh cakap besar, sekali berjaya, itu bukan isteri kau, kembali. So dia bertambah dia jatuh, dan dia punya self-esteem tu kurang sikit.
But the anger.
The anger is about anger. It's about, remember, bantuan saya cakap di saya, but all my films about anger. I'm not happy. LTM, disturbing. It's all kaki bakas, but anger. All about anger. Saya angry on me.
Okay. Okay. Ada yang terakhir sebelum kita tutup. Ada satu ayah Ali.
Okay, 10 tahun lepas tu, U-Wei ada apa arahkan lagi filem Buai Laju-Laju dengan premis ataupun topik yang lebih kurang sama tentang perempuan penggoda, licik. So adakah ada something yang memang tak puas hati tentang filem Perempuan Isteri Jalan dan nak capaikan?
Bukan tak puas hati, just terlalu kan. If you notice Buai Laju-Laju, saya namakan dia, nama dia sama tau, tapi saya tukar je. Zaliha je Zaitun, dan Amir jadi ketiga alphabet dia sama. So saya main konfigurasi lain pula. Yeah. But I'm very proud of this. I'm very proud of this film. You know. Of course, I'm proud of all my films. You know. Just that maybe I'm not satisfied. You know.
Jadi, you sebut tentang trilogi selain Buai Laju-Laju dan Perempuan, lagi satu.
I wanted to write about a movie.
Like we do, it's not
included.
You
didn't
make a trilogy.
No, I did a road movie. Macam kali ni, dia saya dah buka kisah dia dengan siapa yang dilari tu, dengan yang tadi tu. I did a road movie. That she runs from Johor Bahru to Perlis. Yeah. So the experience, another configuration. Di mana?
Story
was that? Yeah, I start writing and I.
Okay.
The terminal, something that appeared.
Yeah. Jadi ada kata-kata terakhir kalau Sofia atau Yui. Rasanya tadi saya mungkin saya boleh tambah jugalah tentang macam betapa berkuasanya Zaliha dan tentang dia sebab karakter, sebab bila karakter sifat penuh, dia akan jadi okey. Sebab yang macam saya perasan juga banyak filem lokal kita kadang cara kamera tu meng-capture what perempuan dia punya gaze tu. Dia kadang ada cara dia menangkap tu kadang sebab watak tu tak fully flash, jadi dia macam objek pada dia, jadi dia tak membawa. Jadi sebab tu saya rasa filem ni berkuasa sebab ada momen-momen macam yang subtle lah, yang tadi macam saya berperasan balik senyum. Mungkin saya tengok lain kali nanti banyak lagi benda yang saya jumpa. Jadi
saya ingat the instruction tu. She feels little bit macam okay, populish lah, tapi dia important sekarang. Mungkin she's nobody. Because dia orang tak ada tahu, satu kampung tak tahu. Jadi dia perhatian diberi, dia influence fashion, semua budak-budak pakai macam budak kan. Jadi dia yang suruh, pergi lah jumpa dia tu. Dan it works. But then he didn't know the apa-apa macam tu, akibat dia betul. Because she's naif juga tau. Because she doesn't think about
konsekuensi
tu. Dia tak, daripada itu tercapai lah dia punya. Dia ada pengaruh sekarang lah. Pengaruh pakaian, pengaruh lisan dia. So ada member.
Ya betul.
Dia semua.
Dan juga waktu di momen-momen terakhir tu, watak Zaliha tu bila tapa nak, dia lambat sikit, dia nak bungkus, nak lari. Tapi Zaliha sebab dia sangat matang lah sebenarnya, daripada awal pun dia dah dia naif, tapi dia matang juga. Dia dah tahu dia dah tahu ya.
Dia cannot run ni. Tapa tu sebenarnya orang luruh gendul sebenarnya.
Dan macam mana siapa nama watak Amir tu bila dekat mesyuarat kampung, sebab saya faham perasaan dia juga, sebab dia dimalukan. Dia kan bila Tapa datang, dia Tapa macam mungkin village idiot kadang-kadang, orang yang macam dikacau-kacau, so dipersendakan. So tu dia ada power dynamic yang kompleks. Dan kenapa Tapa tu pun dia ada memendam juga yang persoalan dia, kenapa dia nak tahu kenapa je. Tapi bila watak Zalia sebut macam tu je, itu memang power lah bagi saya.
Itu key macam tu je, because they are so normal. I mean something special. That means dia tahu pindah, tapi dia tak tahu macam mana dan berbanyak. Dia ada satu scene, I'm sure, dia yang lori scene ada.
Dia lori.
Jadi scene tu bila budak kampung tahan jadi dia tapa yang betul-betul very violent lah. Dia yang
lepas dengan
dia
apa
lah. Dia
lebih-lebih. Jadi okey. Jadi okey. Sofia okey? Okey. Jadi okey. Dengan itu kita boleh tutup. Terima kasih semua yang hadir.